Vikshapati, my dear friend Hanuman Chaudhary, and I am absolutely delighted to be here speaking in honor of such a distinguished academic. I mean, as Mr. Chaudhary was just telling us, that I'm sure there is not another professor who was the dean of three faculties, the principal of three colleges, and the head of seven departments, which range from communication and journalism to psychology to linguistics to philosophy to education to commerce and to business management. So it is a very great honor, and I am very grateful to the organizers for having asked me to speak on this occasion on a subject which is obviously of great importance to the country, and a subject which is which you can expect Mr. Chaudhary to always focus on. And he has already given us a very telling introduction to the dangers that we face, to the dangers the country faces, and I will not dwell too long on them. He has mentioned the salient factors. And if you see, I mean, you just look anywhere and you know the answer to the question which he has posed. In Jammu and Kashmir, as he was saying, you see, at a time when, actually speaking, there has been a great fall in the extent of violence in Kashmir and a great fall in the number of fatalities because of terrorism. This was a golden opportunity for us to focus on improving administration. But what have we done? As he reminded us, at this time, when everything was almost in our favor, we sent these three fellows whom nobody knew as so-called interlocutors. We don't know. As Mr. Jagmohan has always said, that the problem of Kashmir is not in Srinagar. He has said it is not even in Islamabad. The problem is in Delhi. The same thing can be said today about Assam. At least for 25 years, persons like me, like Hanuman Chaudhary, like the Assam students, have been saying the same thing. These have been documented by the Census Commissioner. This infiltration, some of us have compared the population in the neighboring districts in Bangladesh and the districts in Assam and shown how the Assam population has grown by so much more than the Bangladesh population. General Sinha has written about it when he was a governor. The National Security Advisory Board has focused on it. The Supreme Court in the Sonowal case has said that this is now an imminent and grave threat to the security and integrity of India. So what do you mean? But the same thing, the problem of Assam is not in Guwahati, it is not in Dhaka, it is again in Delhi. In the same way, you take a third symptom. These are all symptoms. You see, why is it that the Bangladeshis don't cross the other side and or trek and go beyond Assam into China? Why not? On the other side, why is it that the West Pakistan Punjabis don't come into Punjab? Because if they come, we will kill them. I am from Punjab, I know, you take our land and see what happens. But the poor pacifist SMEs are taken advantage of, and the governments in Delhi go on spinning legalism. In the same way, a third symptom is a person like this fellow Afsal Guru. You see, it is everybody in India says, oh, Parliament is the supreme institution. Here is a man who has been convicted, who is sentenced to death, has been confirmed by the Supreme Court, but the state of India's hands tremble so much that they cannot carry out the orders of the Supreme Court, whether it is on Assam or whether it is on Afzal Guru. And the perverse thing is society. It is a society which has now lost the capacity to draw a line. Chaudhary Sahib was reminding us, co-religionists. Arre bhaiya, there is a line about somebody being from India or not being from India. On Afzal Guru, arcane debates are going on whether death penalty should be there at all in a liberal society. Arre bhaiya, he has attacked the parliament. But we cannot draw the line between death penalty to an ordinary criminal and death penalty to a terrorist. So all these are symptoms of the same thing. In J&K, as I mentioned to you, that when the situation becomes favorable, we create the problem again. In Assam, we neglect the problem which everybody is shouting and screaming about. And then we go on issuing appeals for peace. In Afzal Guru's case, this incapacity to draw a line, incapacity to carry out orders of the highest organs of the state. In Jammu, after all Kashmir is Jammu and Kashmir, there is not a single leader, not one leader who has been to the Hindu refugees in Jammu. They are refugees in our own country. But there is not one person, not one leader who has gone, not one Chidambaram and so on, home minister, gone to them. Why? And the same thing will happen in Assam. And the consequence of that is going to be random violence. Why? Because when the state neglects its primary duty, then society takes the law into its own hands. And that is the prospect that we see. So I will just mention a few of the symptoms. Then I will mention to you what I think are the basic premises of governance, of holding the country together, which we have lost, which we have discarded, and which must be resurrected. And then I will list a few things which need to be done. Some of them are small things, some of them are major things, and what requires to be done in the meantime by each one of us, as Chaudhary Sahib's example shows, as Justice, our judge's example shows, what each of us can do in his little bit. So the situation today is that the government has lost control of the situation. And the Prime Minister has lost control of the government. Actually, we cannot find him. वो रोते ही नजर आते हैं कि मैं इसलिए नहीं कर सकता, मैं उसलिए नहीं कर सकता, टू जी में इन टू चीज अ क्लासिक केस. Sometimes his explanation was, what could I do? The two ministers did not agree. And then when the correspondence showed that those Chidambaram and Raja had agreed on every point, he said in Parliament, what could I do? The two ministers had agreed. So there is a limerick about the Prime Minister. It is the old limerick which applies to him. That the one who was not there yesterday, the one who wasn't there yesterday, was again not there today. How I wish to God he'd go away. And the third point is that Mrs. Sonia Gandhi has lost control of the Congress party. Andhra is a good example, Maharashtra is a good example, Kerala is a good example. What Gogoi is saying today about the central government is a good example. That she has become, and actually speaking, if I may say so, that is the condition of all political leaders and all political parties today. They are these, see, they are the instruments through which we can hold the country together, because you and I can't. We have to do it. We can only appeal to them. We can only hope they will do something, look at the situation and do something. But all of them are in the same category. They are now these wayside shrines. See, when the truck driver is going, he does not stop, goes to paisa, and then drives exactly as he wants to be. If you see the conduct of any chief minister, it is exactly that. So this is a very grave situation, and even more grave, I feel, is the fact that there is now a complete homogenization of all political parties, which are the main instruments through which the country is to be run and through which democracy functions. You have the same corruption, you have the same factionalism, you have the same liberation from ideas and certainly from any ideals. You have, they are all knowledge proof. They are all equally jealous of expertise. And a certain timidity and fright has entered their heart of every single political party. They do not speak the truth. They do not speak the whole truth on any issue whatsoever. And they are as ignorant as we, as each other, about what the people are feeling. Well, like, kitni political parties ki meetings hoti hai. Nahi, nahi, sir, we should oppose petrol price hike. Why? And so it will send a good signal. We should block parliament on price rise. Why? It will send a good signal. They don't know whether the people are receiving the signal or not, in spite of this telephone in every hand. And what is that the people are not? People are not coming out on the streets for them. But they think, sitting in their rooms and meetings, that no. If only we take up, block the parliament like this, then a good signal will go to our core constituency. This is the phrase I got sick of hearing again and again in parliament. But they will not speak the whole truth on reservations. What they will tell you in private is completely different from the stand they will take in public in all political parties. And this ignorance of what is in the minds of the people is manifest at the time that each of them is as surprised by his victory as by his defeat. So therefore, in effect, there is in India today a one-party rule. They have different signboards, but they have the same nature in their political power. And this is the problem. Why Hanuman Chaudhary is so worried? Why our judge is so worried? Why each of you is so worried? Because now there is no other instrument by which you may change something or say something. And therefore, the consequence of this homogenization of political parties also is that therefore it is now very difficult to expect a reform from within the political system, because they are all the same. But on the other hand, their hold on the political system is such that reform from outside is also very difficult. As you have seen in Anna Hazare's case. So, for the reform from outside to work, the situation will really have to become of a tectonic scale. When the plates shift under the earth and an earthquake arises, but for the situation to become that desperate to enable a solution, we do not know what the outcome will be at that time. Because who will be there, how strong his hands will be, to hold the country together when the situation reaches such a catastrophic condition. And I believe this is the reason we must, that there are many lessons from this, and I will take 10 minutes of your time to draw your attention to some of the basic premises which have gone wrong since the time of Dr. Ambedkar and the Constitution being framed. And if you read the Constituent Assembly debates, they are of a different order than what we see today. And unless those basic things are set right, I personally feel that we will just continue to hold seminars and things will continue to go the way they are going. The first of these is, please do not be carried away by your own propaganda. We keep saying we are the largest democracy in the country, but much of what we see today in parliament and outside is not democracy, it is disarray. Very often when we were sitting in parliament, there will be persons, you know, visitors from abroad, from East Europe, from Western Europe, there is a particular portion of the Rajya Sabha in which they will sit, or the Lok Sabha, as visitors to see Indian democracy functioning. And people are shouting and screaming. So very, you say quickly, that unko le jao na. That is democracy. That is disarray. Second thing we must see is that infections spread. What used to happen in state legislatures as an exception became the rule in state legislatures. But we always say, no, to Bihar mein ho raha hai, are bhaiya wo Lucknow mein ho raha hai. But the same people are now in parliament, and so what used to happen in state legislatures now happens in parliament. So infections spread. They spread faster than anybody could have imagined. You see the spread of the galloping cancer like corruption. How it has spread? I remember only 30 years ago, when I started writing on these matters, my father, who had been a civil servant, he said, this is not possible what you are writing. I have worked in the government for 35 years. It could never happen. Are you sure about your facts? And just see, if you talk today about an honest minister, people say, are you sure about your facts? And that infection, the scale becomes much greater. I know when Antony had to leave his office, the article I had written was only about 5 crores. Bofors was only about 64 crores. Abhi Raja ke 64 crores se to daant bhi geele nahi honge. And what is worse is that that infection spreads to all institutions in society. That is the national service which General B.K. Singh has done. He has shown us, just by lifting the lid, that the same type of corruption, the same type of factionalism has entered the highest reaches of the Indian army. So you can imagine, we are talking about Assam. What will the Indian army do vis-a-vis China? And very often countries are misled from the gravity of the situation that Hanuman Chaudhary was pointing out to, because of a very important factor, that their adversary is preoccupied with other things. The decline in violence in Kashmir is because Pakistan today is preoccupied with its own problem. So we think, we have solved Kashmir. Because the basic thing has not been attended to. Similarly, in the case of China, China has today benchmarked itself against the United States. That is why it is not looking at India. But one slap and it will be the same problem. And then for 30 years we will again be having reports as to who was responsible. UPA, NDA, UPA 1, UPA 2, Indira Gandhi, Pandit Nehru, same report. And the problems go on swelling. And that individuals, actually speaking, cannot handle those problems. Even collections of individuals cannot handle the problem. You and I cannot handle the problem of the Bangladeshi infiltration. It is on such a scale. It can only be handled by an efficient state, by a determined, clear-headed state, the state of India. And that is the problem I want you to focus on when I start on what we have to do. And finally, there is nobody in India has time for the real problems that are around the corner. For instance, China. China does not now say that it has changed its security doctrine completely. First, it used to be war within China by drawing the invader into China and then finishing him by guerrilla warfare. That was the Maoist doctrine. Then it became, no, war at the borders of China. Then it became a war at the borders of China under high technology conditions. That was Deng Xiaoping's reformulation. Then it became war by managing the periphery. That means those countries that can affect China. And that periphery now includes the United States also. And they said this occupying a territory, going into other people's territory with lakhs of soldiers, this is an old warfare. We don't believe in this now. We must, they say, hit the acupuncture points of another society. I mean, you can find volumes and volumes of China on this. We will go and put up some tanks in the North East. But they say, we will hit, India is an integrating, modernizing society. Therefore, if we will hit those points, which are the nodes of Indian integration. For instance, the District 20 power grid through cyber warfare. Power grid, air traffic control, railway traffic control, financial transactions, banking transactions, broadcasting, telephony, 20 such items. But nobody cares. I remember, I'll give you just one instance. Because this would be not, you can imagine, this is done in 2 minutes. In 2 minutes, all these systems are disrupted. Therefore, when I was there, I started firewalling exercises for firewalling our infrastructure. And by discussion with Mr. Brijesh Mishra, who was our national security advisor at that time, a memorandum was issued, a secret order was issued by Brijesh Mishra as national security advisor that no Chinese equipment will be used in Indian telecom infrastructure. Because the Chinese put bugs into this thing which can be activated by satellites. And then the whole communication is disrupted in 1 second flat. It is therefore banned in the UK. This is banned in the United States. Government saying the files went to Bharat, to the new government. He endorsed the previous decision. 15 days later, he reversed it after some people met him in Chennai. So now Chinese equipment is in our telecom infrastructure, and we are thinking of that only infiltrators from across the border will come to disintegrate us. But nobody has the time. I narrated this instance in the presence of the Prime Minister in Parliament. Arre, Raja is sitting here. The scientists who were working on this matter have come to me, the Defence Forces people have come to me. Sir, please go to the Prime Minister, tell him that all that exercise has been abandoned. a culture of avoidance comes when you don't attend to problems. Then you minimize the problem. And in society, the culture of acceptance comes. And that sets the stage for complete disintegration. Today, if one of these corrupt ministers came in, people will stand up. Well, we have accepted them. But can you imagine Gandhiji's time? Can you imagine the Constituent Assembly's time that three ministers in two states in the north are today implicated in the murder of their mistresses? Amkete ji satyam mil jayate, Gandhiji ki photo lagate, Vande Mataram gaate, aur situation ye hai. So the last point in this, and then I'll come to what we should do, is to remember that their evil is done with our hands. Please don't think that these are leaders we have elected, or by not voting we have allowed them to be elected. Could these corporate frauds have happened without the active connivance and collaboration of chartered accountants? Or their financial auditors or advisors? Could ministers make money without the civil servants doing the paperwork? Could criminals thrive in India without lawyers, the best lawyers being available to them? Can a judge be bribed without the intercession of lawyers? Is there a bribe which has been received before it has been given? Therefore, that is the place to begin. It is our own conduct. You want the country to survive? We must make sure that our conduct, whatever the consequences, is one that befits something we call our motherland. The second point is that the root of this problem is the legislatures. Because in the Indian constitutional system, it is from the legislature that the executive is chosen. That executive, the cabinet, the council of ministers, the ruling party, they set the ethos of the civil service, they select the judges, they develop liaisons with various kinds across institutions. They appoint the vice-chancellors. So they set the tone. And what is the catchment area for the executive? It is the legislature. And in this, there is a simple law, the Indiresan law. Professor P. Indiresan, one of our great technologists, he once asked me, why do you think, what is the explanation for our current institution? So I was going to say something about caste. Is it not an Indiresan law? Indiresan law? He said, you don't know Indiresan law? I said, no, I don't know. He said, simple. Second-rate person to select third-rate person. And you do this for 30, 40 years and that is what happens now. Because they become the UPSC for selecting the next round of legislators. So they select persons who will be their henchmen, their weak men, compromised men, salivating men looking for the next post. These are the qualifications they look for. You look at our previous president, Pratibha Patil. Inconsequential persons. So they should know that I owe my position exactly to the benefactor. So I will do exactly what he or she says. So in every institution we look for such persons. And if we get an independent man, an election commissioner, a good judge, look at the end, you can say, oh, galti hongi. Aage se aisi galti na ho. Ki aise aadmi kaise select ho gaye. So you get all institutions infected by the rot which has affected our legislatures. So that is the main point to focus on in reforming and saving India and preventing its disintegration. For this purpose, it is very necessary to change some of the basic concepts that we have. A representative in the legislature is not my representative whose job it is, or my class representative whose job is to find my brother-in-law a job, or my father-in-law a bank loan. No. His job is to assess issues and policies from the point of view of the country as a whole. That was Edmund Burke. So that unless we change the concept of who a representative is, we cannot survive, because they will then only, it will then be the lowest common denominator of sectional aspirations, not a national aspiration. The second point is that governance in India is regarded as the thing that can be left to the uneducated. You want to join Tata Consultancy Services? A lot of qualifications. You want to become a PM in a government? Some qualifications. But you want to become, that skill, that dedication is not with everybody at a particular time. Everyone does not have that. Very few people have that. That is why Thomas Jefferson's phrase that governance must be in the hands of what he called a natural aristocracy. Not the aristocracy of birth, of privilege, of money, but the aristocracy of talent, of capacity, of the ability and dedication to do that particular job at that particular time. In the end, everybody can acquire that capacity, true, but the job has to be done today. And everybody does not have the capacity today. These are today dismissed as elitist thoughts. But that is the way in which countries lose their moorings. And unless the system puts governance in the hands and great policy decisions about Assam, about J&K and all, in such hands of persons who have that capacity and dedication, not persons who are representative of the people in the sense that they are like the people. That if the people caste is this, their caste is that. If the people of this area want this particular religion to be voted into power, they have that religion. If the people are only 30% literate, this fellow is also only 30% literate. That is representative. That is not the basis of how governance can go on in India. This natural aristocracy must be held to the highest standard. Once you compromise, then the slope is so steep and so slippery that you will not be able to prevent the complete abandonment of standards. What has happened in India now with this so-called rhetoric of the common people? It has happened that standards are, today mediocrity has become the norm. Standards are spat upon as a conspiracy of the well-to-do to keep the poor down. Intimidation has become argument. Vulgarity has become a right. And assault has become proof. Because I can beat you, therefore I am right. This is democracy. So you must hold that elite to the highest standard, no slippage, no compromise. And one way, nobody will always be good, therefore eternal vigilance is the price of liberty. You have to monitor them ceaselessly. That does not happen in India. In the United States, if you appointed a judge to the Supreme Court, there will be 10 organizations which would have worked day and night from the time he became a judge in a small court till today. They would have studied his record, the quality of his judgments. And then they will be able to comment and assess him. But have you found an Indian academic doing work on assessing judgments of the Supreme Court? Never. So we don't monitor them. So give governance to those persons who have the national interest at heart. Give it to that small group. Hold them to the highest standard and monitor them day and night. Now to do any of this, I think 5-6 things have to be done, and then I'll finish with this. First is, realize that even in this condition, several Indian institutions, even of the government, work. ISRO works. The Atomic Energy Establishment works. How? Because of Panditji's foresight, those institutions have remained insulated from political and bureaucratic interference. So insulate institutions is the first point. Second is that where possible, have re-examined the methods of appointment. For instance, why is it that our election commission works? Because the committee of rivals ensures that the election commissioner who is appointed and the others who are appointed there are such in whom you can at least have a hope that they will work impartially. Third, I believe that we should not go on setting up new institutions. That is why I never felt very enthusiastic about this whole discussion about the Lokpal. You see, what is the situation in India? The sequence is, there is a problem. We neglect the problem. It grows bigger. We look the other side. It grows even bigger. Looking the other side, we shut our eyes. It explodes. So we say, set up another institution. 10 years later, the problem is still there and the institution has become a new problem. So you set up this Lokpal. No. You want to eradicate corruption? Do 4 simple things. Look at the existing law. Very simple things can be done. 1. Judges should never allow any adjournment in cases involving public service. Simple point. You see the cases going on in the UK, in the US, that man who defrauded $50 billion of investors' funds, he defrauded Madoff, right?
Madoff.
But yes, 3 months he's in jail. 3 months. Rajat Gupta's case, 3 months. Here, terrorist cases of Bengal, Maharashtra since 1991, 92 are still going on in the first case. So Raja will be, we will be gone by the time Raja. So, no adjournment. Second, just change the rule of evidence. Today it is beyond reasonable doubt. But actually, if you Sukhram, you find 5 crores under Sukhram's bed, why should it be necessary for the CBI to prove beyond reasonable doubt that he got it from somewhere? If the onus should be on him, that the preponderance of probability is that he was such a frugal man that out of his salary of 10,000 rupees, he saved 5 crores. Justice Venkatachalaya's commission has said this. Even Moyle's commission, Second Administrative Reforms Commission, has said, change the rule of evidence. And finally, that the punishment must be such, no fine. It must involve physically jailing the man for 7 years and permanently barred from public life. Do these things rather than waste time trying to have a new Lokpal which will become another court. Same lawyers, same types of judges, same interminable things going on forever. So these are simple things that can be done. But the next, I think that there are other simple things that should be done in regard to the electoral system. For instance, we must have qualifications for legislators. If you see the end where Hanuman Chaudhary was quoting Dr. Ambedkar's excellent and brilliant speech at the conclusion of the Constituent Assembly, but one speech was there after Ambedkar had spoken, and that was Dr. Rajendra Prasad's speech. As the presiding officer, he closed the assembly. He thanks everybody. Then he says that there are two regrets I have. One, that we have not been able, one which can be easily remedied, which will be remedied. That is, that we have not been able to come up with the Hindi translation in time. But that will come. But the second problem is that we have not been able to specify the qualifications for legislators. And for this, the country will pay dearly. So, what a prophetic remark. 65 years later, we should at least attend to that particular problem of qualifications for legislators. Second, this first past the post system means, do you know that 99.3, if you have, there's a book of mine called The Parliamentary System, if you see 99.3% of the Lok Sabha, the persons were elected with less than, on a minority vote, 60% were elected less than 40% vote. 40% were elected by less than 25% of the vote. Sir, Justice Venkatesalaya's commission gave the instances of persons in the state legislature who had been elected to the house though they had lost their deposit. Because even in that condition they got more than the others. So this should be replaced. Because then what is the incentive? The incentive is inflame 10-15% of the population of one religion or the other, as you are seeing in Andhra. Inflame them, frighten them, bribe them, bamboozle them, and somehow get into the house. And the more fractured the house, the better the chances that you have of becoming a minister. So this should be replaced. You must have a two-round election as in France. Anybody can stand in the first round. In the second round, which is held only 3 days later, it can be held in 3-4 days later, only the first two stand for election. So whoever gets elected gets more than 50% of the vote. And secondly, have compulsory voting. So that you enlarge the number of persons whom a fraudulent man who is bent upon inflaming a particular section which sees itself as a section different from the country as a whole, as Chaudhary was just reminding us that the minorities feel and are made to feel that you are different from the country as a whole, that incentive will go, because he now has to get a much larger population to bamboozle them with, and he will have to round off his corner. He would have to represent the interests of a much larger constituency than of a particular group. And finally, that we should go and enforce the rules. Simple point, just enforce the rules. On its anniversary, 50th anniversary, the Parliament passed a resolution. Parliament said that anybody stepping into the whole Parliament, joint session, anybody stepping into the well of the house will be automatically suspended. Do you see any presiding officer enforcing it? Why not? Because he is celebrating. He is looking for the next job. So he does not want to offend anybody. So these simple things should be done. And I personally feel that you need to go much farther than this. The first point to do is cut the cord between the executive and the legislature to a large extent. The chief executive should be elected by the whole country, and he can select a cabinet from outside the legislature also. And unlike the American system where you get best people, just look at our defense ministers, man. What competence they have and what competence Panetta has.
he's been the head of CIA. He's their defense minister. So, but today, you cannot get such experts elected to the legislature, and the best meaning prime minister is confined to choosing from within the legislature. So you can't get experts in the most important jobs in India. So it changed that one third of the cabinet can be selected from outside the legislature. But unlike the American system, we should have a system in which you can have the person, he is not a member of the legislature, so he cannot vote in the legislature, but he participates in the debates of the legislature. That is not a radical formulation. Dr. Manmohan Singh, being a member of the Rajya Sabha, cannot vote in the Lok Sabha, but he participates. Maybe that is wrong. Some other Prime Minister will have the occasion to participate in the Lok Sabha debates. So such changes. And the upper chamber, do you know, we said we talk about this elitism, do you know which country is now thinking of having an upper chamber which will be a house of talent and achievement? Rajaji said it, but which country is today going to have it? That the upper house shall be a house of talent and achievement. It's China. They are thinking of having a house of elite achievers and elite talented people with their expertise. That will be the upper chamber. Now why can't we think of it? Because we have hobbled ourselves with these false notions. No, 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 that will be inequality, that will be nonsense. I have other more radical proposals, you will find them in that book, but I personally feel that unless such changes are thought of, let me just give you one and then I'll finish. Can I take 5 more minutes, sir? Just one. You see, today our constituencies are large, but still they are amenable to that kind of inflaming only 10%. And you cannot get good persons, talented people, to come into the house. You can't get Palkhiwala there, though we owe the dike of the basic structure to Palkhiwala. Why? He does not have the money. He is a Parsi, so he doesn't have the cars. He will not use black money. He does not have access to a criminal network. So he can't come. But how to enable him to come? So in the German system, it is a list system. You don't go and vote for a candidate. You vote for the list put up by a party. Now in India, we are so large that we can't have one list of 540 persons. Because a person who has done very good work in Kerala will not be known in Assam, and vice versa. So, Mr. L.P. Singh suggested, club the neighboring 10 constituents. In that, have a list of each political party. So, every political party would have an incentive of having at least one or two good persons on its list, so as to give luster to its entire list. So the Congress gets 30% of the votes. Therefore, of the 10 seats, 3 will go to the Congress. But I have a modification of that problem, of the proposal, that you should not have, every party should not put up 10 candidate list. Every party should put up a 30 candidate list. And when the Congress gets 30% of the votes, and is allowed to have 3 persons from that 10-member constituency in the House, then which 3 of those 30 should go should be determined by a lottery. Why? Because then you are weakening the influence of money, you are weakening the influence of caste, you are weakening the influence of Muslim, non-Muslim, you are weakening, completely erasing the influence of the candidate having some nexus with the criminal network. So I personally feel that my proposals are that what we are seeing today in Assam, in J&K, in Afzal Guru, with all the things that Hanuman Chaudhary was listing and our judge in his sagacious way was hinting towards, those are symptoms of the fact that this constitutional system is not working and requires both simple modifications and a re-look in a big way. The interesting thing is that this was an active debate till the 1970s. Well, you have Mr. B.K. Nehru's Rajaji Memorial Lecture, pleading for the constitution to be changed to a presidential system. You have Jayaprakash Narayan's famous lecture on a plea for the reconstruction of Indian polity. You have Mr. L.P. Singh, a great administrator, giving proposals. But by the 42nd Amendment, the whole thing was shut off. Because people said any tinkering with the constitution means that somebody is planning to bring a dictatorship into the country. I feel that those of us who are outside the system should revise that particular debate and work out proposals in detail. And then we will be able to really contribute to saving the situation from what it has begun, from what it has become, and that is how we will be honoring, and not just paying lip service to the memory of such a distinguished academic like Professor Ganesh. Thank you so very much. Thank you. There are earthquakes of scandals and tsunamis of shame. But why is the UPA2 government is still not shaken enough to fall?
Sir, before I answer that question, from what Ms. Chaudhary was saying, there was one argument in favor of Rahul Gandhi becoming Prime Minister is that as he's unmarried, maybe dynastic rule will make it finish.
No.
As to why the UPA government doesn't fall is because nobody is sure of what the election will bring to him. The opposition party, one of the biggest opposition leaders, I met him the other day, one of the persons for whom I have very high regard, and you can guess who he is. I asked him, sir, what is your assessment of the current situation? उन्होंने कहा कि लोग इस सरकार से खफा हैं, मगर हमारे से भी निराश हैं. That is why the people are not being enthused. You see, it is not enough to say Congress is doing something wrong. I must have the set of candidates whose character and record is such that everybody will believe that if we came to power, then things will really be different. Then they will flock. And that is what the opposition doesn't seem to realize. They think that because they can plant stories about themselves or against their other rivals in the same political party, this having mass-based in six journalists, this is where many of the leaders in Delhi have. Mass base of six journalists. And India is being run by them. Indian discourse is being run by them. So, that is the reason that the UPA too survives, flourishes, loots, evades, passes the buck, and no problem. Because there is no visible alternative which is completely of a different culture.
As a mother of 60 years, please tell me, how can I be of some help to this nation?
One, the first is of being a good mother. Nobody will bring up children and make adults who will have the values which all of us feel the country requires than the mothers will. Second, as a citizen, each of us can do things. Take up one issue, on that become the expert in the country. Take up one institution, a very small institution, like your Resident Welfare Association. make, improve that. Learn to use the new instruments which even such governments have had willy-nilly given to give us. For instance, the Right to Information Act. Learn to use it and use it to pursue one office or one officer or one minister whom you regard as corrupt. Similarly, learn to use the new media, because the media today is a part of the problem. The established media, it's not a part of the solution. So learn to use. Now, for instance, this is a very good example we have today of a blog. It liberates us from the standard media. Each of us can do that and thereby spread the facts which are in the which Hanuman Chaudhary can decide at a moment's notice. So many things that we can do as individuals.
Here is a question about the media itself. Media, apart from, one second, media apart from government is disintegrating the society. Not the country, it is disintegrating the society by meaningless pseudo-secularism and 24-hour broadcast of reality. How a responsible citizen can control the media, National Broadcasting Association does not even bother to monitor. How do we change this?
Yeah, very simple. Don't watch them in TV. Why do you watch them? I don't understand. Be like, at least in this matter, let us be like Gandhi. He did not read newspapers. He writes.
N.T. Ramarao also did not read newspapers.
But anyhow, Gandhiji did not. He said because they are, in those days, newspapers actually focused on very big things. But Gandhiji said these are trivial, passing things. So I am not going to spend time on it. Somebody will bring something to his attention. This is what so and so Times of India has reported. Then he will issue a clarification. So if we look at them and then say, well, they are disintegrating, they are superficial, they are just the same six fellows shouting at each other, it is a waste of time. Why look at them? You have the remote in your hand. Switch off.
Why is it that we always have a timid approach whenever we deal with the national integrity and security of our nation? If some people go on rampage in Bombay, saying Assamese get out or let him go on for the road, nobody bothers about it.
No, the reason for that is precisely that the candidates are elected from constituencies in which they depend on those 15%. So the nation's interests are never in their mind. What is the origin of secularism of the CPIM? The Muslim vote bank in West Bengal and in Kerala. And when you treat the Muslims as a bank, then naturally they also get a group identity. They realize that, no, this is my power. So it becomes a vicious circle. That is why the governments are timid and paralyzed. Because there will always be 20 MPs in any sir, as in Karna. There will in fact be 20 ministers there who will not let you do it.
Thank you very much. I think we will do the questions.
Finally, Udit Raj very recently, he is a leader of the Dalits. He had gone to Srikakulam and said, we want Dalitistan. And there is a map of Dalitistan consisting of parts of Odisha, parts of Andhra Pradesh, parts of Jharkhand, parts of something, etc. In the year 2000, in the Economic and Political Weekly, which is a leftist weekly, Professor Amar Abbas has made out a case for Mughalistan. India should be divided again. Mughalistan created with the big parts of Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, etc., and up to Pakistan. But he is late. Actually, Mr. T.P. Rajeshwar Rao, the head of IB, who became the governor of West Bengal, when he was the governor of West Bengal, wrote a report to the President of India
that actually the third partition of India is imminent. And he gave a map. And saying, this is where already the population demographic balance has changed. And that included parts of Odisha, parts of Bihar, parts of Bengal, West Bengal, and large part of Assam. And nothing happened. Therefore, when he retired as the governor, he then wrote those articles in the Hindustan Times, the Congress paper, and sent them to me. And you will find that account also in one of my books. But he said, "Oh, Aranya Rodham, crying in the wilderness." So this gentleman who has now asked for the demand, he is only repeating, he is now concretizing the forecast of the head of IB, a person very loyal to this family and Congress and the governor of West Bengal.
Thank you, sir.